And now, Kappo and the Rev present a KaTR classic, Anne of Green Gables.
Oh my, Marilla. Isn't this intro like a cherry blossom that one should just behold and enjoy?
No, not at all. It is time for Chapter 6, Marilla Makes Up Her Mind.
The drive to White Sands hadn't been the horror that Marilla had expected. Quite the opposite, in fact, as Anne's proud and joyful attitude in the face of her unknown but assuredly tragic fate had begun to inspire Marilla.
Marilla had expected a whole host of outbursts along the way. Whining, crying, bald-faced manipulations, and an attempt to sway her opinion, but there was none of the sort. If anything, Anne had seemed to accept her fate and wasn't the least bit interested in worrying about it as the buggy skipped along joyfully through the breathtaking countryside.
If Marilla Cuthbert had everything to do over again, she wouldn't mind trading places with this young, wild weed of a girl, Anne with an E, Shirley. Marilla saw great promise for Anne in a world where the stuffy chauvinistic society seemed to be giving way to a new light. The horizon had everything to gain for the fair sex, voting rights, equal pay for equal work, and all sorts of breakthroughs that ultimately would pass Marilla Cuthbert.
Yes, it would go down on her tombstone that she never married, and therefore never fully took the yoke of male domination. Yet Marilla longed for love more now than in the days of her youth when she had the choice of many suitors.
There were many thoughts that hadn't come up in years, and they flooded Marilla's mind to a point where her sense of humor took the reins by default.
I'll tell you what, Miss Shirley. I'm guessing the mare knows her way back to Green Gables. What say you drive her home, and I'll head on to the asylum.
Marilla swayed her head and hat with a smile.
Anne laughed, and Marilla joined her with a smile.
Can you imagine what Matthew would say?
What have you done with her?
Marilla impersonated Matthew.
Oh, Matthew.
Anne grabbed Marilla by the arm.
She ran off with a dashing gentleman to ride the rails all the way to British Columbia. Marilla laughed.
He would say,
about time.
And put the kettle on.
Marilla continued to laugh far more than she had in quite some time. Yes, and Matthew, he could finally run off with Mr. Iverson.
What?
Marilla said with a start, the moment of frivolity ending abruptly. Most moments of frivolity ended abruptly when it came to Marilla C. Cuthbert. Oh, I simply wanted to explain what I...
Hold what I your tongue.
Marilla stared daggers through the child.
Anne wilted entirely, turned and muttered to herself.
He might be holding Angus Iverson's tongue right now.
Quiet.
Marilla shouted, having the keenest ear on Prince Edward Island.
Never speak of an elder that way again.
Yes, Miss Cuthbert.
Anne halted and looked directly down the road.
You can ride the rails yourself, young lady, all the way back to the asylum.
Marilla huffed and snapped the reins of the mare, and they picked up speed.
This was the moment that the feeling became cemented in the mind of Marilla Cuthbert. She knew she would never be free of this child. She could send Anne Shirley to an asylum deep within the African continent or perhaps the Asian tundra, and she knew she would hear from Anne Shirley again. By the sheer bewitching nature of this red-haired she-devil, it became certain that the Cuthbert family would be forever woven into a larger, overarching story well beyond their control.
Marilla had allowed herself on 3 or 4 occasions now to soften on this child, and she was beginning to wonder how she truly felt about the matter. She had hardly the time to think about any of these happenings, as everything seemed so frantic as it unfolded. By the time the two pulled up to the Spencer home in White Sands, Marilla Cuthbert had made up her mind 6 times and was closing in on the 7th.
Standing on the front porch of the big yellow house was Mrs. Spencer, clad in a fine afternoon dress, and next to her was the unmistakable figure of Mrs. Peter Bluett.
If Matthew Cuthbert had Angus Iverson as his local lookalike or doppelganger, Matilda Stilden, as Marilla knew her, mainly by her maiden name, had gone on to marry Peter Bluett. The idea of even mentioning the name Mrs. Bluett and not referring to herself in some afternoon fantasy brought Marilla into a near rage.
Yoo-hoo, Marilla!
Mrs. Spencer bounced down the long front staircase and ambled up next to the buggy, petting the sorrel mare on the mane.
You're the last person I expected to see this day.
Hello, Sarah.
Marilla nodded, noticing that Mrs. Bluett had stayed at the top of the stairs and had sat in a large plush chair and sipped a refreshing drink with an audibly loud... Marilla rolled her eyes and began.
I'm here because there must be some queer mistake. We sent word by Roberta that we wanted a boy for Green Gables.
A boy?
Sneered Mrs. Spencer as she looked at Anne with the eyes of a beaten hound dog. Anne peered back knowingly as if to comfort Mrs. Spencer, who had immediately discerned the heartbreaking nature of this afternoon's call.
Of course, a boy.
Marilla snapped with a fractured brow.
Why on earth would anyone send for an orphan girl?
Mrs. Spencer smiled nervously as she waved over to the young girl who was playing by the family well.
Well, my Angusina is getting along wonderfully here.
She just poured something in your well, Sarah. What is going on over there?
Marilla pointed as the young Angusina Iversonius, who had lived alongside Anne at the asylum, did indeed pour something down the well.
Angusina! Dear!
Mrs. Spencer shooed her away from the well.
Mrs. Spencer, we simply need to know how to return the girl to the orphanage. Can you provide me with the details, please?
Well, as I live and breathe,
Mrs. Spencer said, stunned.
I was just speaking with our old friend, Mrs. Peter Bluett, about this very thing. She has been blessed with a new set of twins and is looking for a girl of 11 or 12 to help her.
Anne and Marilla shared a shudder and a scoff, but neither of them noticed the other. To Mrs. Spencer, there was little left for her to do but laugh nervously and make motion to Matilda Stilden, who was now proudly Mrs. Peter Bluett. She came down the staircase, a shrewish-faced woman without an ounce of superfluous flesh on her bones. It seemed Peter Bluett had been looking for someone an ounce or two lighter and a touch or two more homely than Marilla Cuthbert, but only just so.
Matilda was a sourpussed old woman, yet shockingly, she was still having children well into her 60s. Her latest set of twins, bringing the number of her cantankerous brood up to a jaw-dropping 26. Matilda was the spitting image of Marilla, yet only slightly younger. The two had shared a friendship throughout their girlhood, but their obvious similarities only seemed to magnify their glaring differences. The two had taken to competing and quarreling with each other far more than friendly socializing. By the time Marilla had, rather unpolitely, uninvited herself to the Bluett wedding, their friendship was over. Some 40 years had passed, but it mattered not. Matilda picked up right where she left off.
Good day to you, Marilla.
Good day to you, Mrs. Bluett.
Marilla said, as if transforming the word Bluett into a terrifically foul term. Mrs. Spencer began,
Mrs. Cuthbert was just telling me about this awful queer mistake in where they had sent for a boy and...
How old are you, girl?
Mrs. Bluett asked, with her eyes dilating upon this new orphan she now had as an option for cheap slave labor.
11 last March,
Anne said, as her mouth betrayed a heart that wanted nothing to do with Mrs. Peter Bluett.
Well, you are wiry,
Matilda said as she looked the frame of the child up and down.
And I know it's the wiry ones that work the hardest.
Well, if this isn't some kind of divine providence, then I don't know what is,
shouted Mrs. Spencer, who estimated, knowing these women, that this transaction would be completed within the next minute.
Girl!
Shouted Mrs. Bluett, who didn't seem to care about learning Anne's name and certainly with no concern as to its spelling.
I'll expect you to act smart and be respectful.
Matilda smiled at Marilla, and when she smiled, her ugliness spiked tenfold. This was just another chance to take something from Marilla Cuthbert, and that was sweet enough for her, much less her new free labor. Well, now I oughtn't be so hasty.
Marilla interjected as she smiled, her whimsy shining through her priggish demeanor. 10 times the whimsy Matilda Stilden, a.k.a. Mrs. Peter Bluett, had ever had in her entire well-sexed yet boring life.
I think I ought to bring her home again and speak this over with Matthew.
Marilla snapped the reins on the sorrel mare and it clomped its hoof forward. Anne blushed with a great and wondrous smile, unsure that any of what she was hearing was real.
Mrs. Spencer.
Marilla nodded.
Mrs. Bluett.
Marilla nodded again and the two locked eyes. Marilla had said Bluett as if she were vomiting up a bad meal, and the rivals stared each other down as the little mare pulled the cart extremely slowly up to the front gate.
It took a very, very long time for the mare to get up the strength to turn the cart and then drag it back uphill towards the road. The poor old thing had been walked and ran something fierce over the past few days and was far worse the wear. The entire time the mare struggled and winced, Marilla kept a cold glare directly centered on Matilda Bluett as the two exchanged the bitterness of 40 years of shunning in a long and powerful glower. Anne watched as Marilla stared pitilessly at the awful old woman. She seemed to be narrowly avoiding serving and muttered to herself,
"Thank God for bitter old ladies."
And there you have it. Apparently my mind is all made up, if you could believe this, Kappo and the Rev. This has been Chapter 6 of the KaTR Classic, Anne of Green Gables. Marilla makes up her mind.